CAMAS 2018. He is winner of CIAKM Analytic Cup 2017 and finalist for Innovative Application in Analytics Award IAA 2020 at Informs Analytics Society. His current research interest includes multi-agent systems, reinforcement learning, and artificial intelligence. He has published several research papers in the national and international journals and conferences. It's a great honor to have you as speaker for this session. Welcome you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Bansal. Thank you for inviting me, and it's great to be here. So before we start, can you confirm me how much time we are going to have today for the lecture?
So you have time till 3:30, one and a half hour.
Okay, thank you. Okay, if I'm overshooting, please let me know, okay? So I'll share my screen. So hello everyone, good afternoon. And today we are going to discuss about reinforcement learning methods. So this is again another kind of machine learning method. So we'll discuss about that, what kind of machine learning method this is and how it is going to help you with your 5G network and, you know, and a lot of network related tasks. So I'm not going to actually focus on any specific network related problem, but I will have a very general discussion of reinforcement learning, although I'll give you some insights about the kind of applications, you know, that can utilize this kind of learning method. So was told, I'm Shashi Shekhar Jha. I'm currently an assistant professor at the Department of Computer Science and Engineering at IIT Roorpee. So the picture that you see in the background is our newly constructed campus, still a very new IIT, and we're still constructing the campus. So any of you visiting nearby areas, Chandigarh, do come to campus and visit. So we'll start the lecture now. So if you look or talk about machine learning methods, okay, so usually there are two very prominent methods. One is called the supervised learning method, and the other one is called the unsupervised learning methods, right? In supervised learning method, mostly we talk about classification kind of task or regression kind of task. So all your image tagging kind of problem, or the problems related to prediction problems, or the problems related to recommendation systems, mostly lies here, right? So you can say image classification, customer retention, weather forecast, these kind of machine learning models, some machine learning problems are worked upon using supervised learning. Then there are unsupervised learning tasks, and in unsupervised learning tasks, without actually having the ground truth data, just based on the features of the data, we try to group them, or, you know, try to level them in different categories and groups. So that is mostly unsupervised learning, you know, like customer segregation, or, you know, feature elicitation or structure discovery, something like this. So these are mostly right, and even most of the deep models, if you ask me, they lie here in supervised learning tasks. So they're very good at doing supervised learning tasks, right? There is a third learning method, and that is called reinforcement learning. What happens in reinforcement learning is, basically, we try to learn without any available knowledge. So we don't initially assume that we have a lot of data to learn, or at least we have a lot of ground truth data to learn. We do have some kind of data in reinforcement learning, and that kind of data is called interaction data. So this reinforcement learning focuses on learning via interaction. Okay, so it's like prominent example would be the autonomous vehicles, you know, the self-driving cars. How do they learn? So you don't provide a kind of fixed level of ground truth information that, you know, how to drive a car in different kind of varying traffic scenarios. So how do they learn? Basically by driving again and again, by gaining experience. So that is what we call interaction. Every time you're driving the car, there is some interaction going on, and you're trying to learn from those interactions. So all those kind of learning is captured into this reinforcement learning framework. Okay. So here you have real time decision making, robot navigation. So that's why self-driving car and everything is here, and skill acquisition and so on. So here I have listed a few of the general applications of reinforcement learning, just to motivate you that what are different variety of problems reinforcement learning can deal with. So like the first one talks about flight stunt maneuvers in a helicopter. So here is a picture, if you can see, and in this picture, there is a helicopter which is flying upside down. So this is the rotor of the helicopter, right? And it is flying upside down. So this is a very difficult maneuver to do in a helicopter. Okay, and even for an expert pilot, this kind of maneuver would be very difficult to achieve. But a few researchers from Stanford in the last decade, they used supervised learning, and then they trained a helicopter. First, they trained the helicopter to fly by itself, and then they also trained the helicopter to do a lot of stunts and maneuvers, which is very difficult for a human pilot to do. So such kind of things can be achieved using reinforcement learning. Autonomous driving, I already gave the example. Similarly, robotic control. Then these initial examples are mostly very hardware-related examples. You know, you are talking of hard things like robots, vehicles, helicopter. But then even for the soft tasks, like managing an investment portfolio. Okay, so what you, in your investment portfolio, you either buy a share or you sell a share. So even you can design a reinforcement learning algorithm which automatically decides that which shares to sell and which shares to buy, such that in the long run, your profits are always going to get better. So such kind of tasks can also be designed using reinforcement learning. Then online advertisement is there. Control of a power station. So nowadays, there's a lot of talk going on about smart grids. And you know, a lot of things that can be done on smart grid. And one of the most prominent thing in the smart grid that they are trying to do is this prediction of demand and supply, how much they should create the electricity which can match the demand in all kinds of scenarios. So then if you look for research paper, there are a lot of work using reinforcement learning in order to do that kind of predictions. Then a few more. Defeating the World Go champion. This is a famous one, this particular application where actually this actually attracted a lot of attention from the research community, which started looking into reinforcement learning and then deep reinforcement learning models, because there is a Chinese game called Go, and it's a very difficult game. It's a board game, but this game has around 10 to power 140 number of state. So the state space is huge. So for very long, it was a challenge for scientists to design a computer algorithm that can, you know, defeat a human in this game. And ultimately, Google's DeepMind scientist did achieve a victory against humans. And they designed, again, using reinforcement learning, a computer algorithm that defeated the World Go champion. So we'll touch upon actually, not this one, but this this work where a deep reinforcement learning model was designed to play different Atari games. So we'll touch upon this. It's specific to your 5G network. So, you know, I looked into, so I'm not a networks person, but yeah, I work in AI and reinforcement learning. So I went and looked into that, what are different kinds of work people are trying to do for 5G mobile networks using deep reinforcement learning. So particular application areas that was listed again on one of the papers, very recent one in 2019 in Vehicular Technology Magazine, is these kind of things like power control and power management. You can achieve these kind of applications using reinforcement learning, computational offloading and edge caching, intelligent transportation, and network slicing. I hope you guys would know more about network slicing and, you know, other applications than me. But yes, you can find the use of reinforcement learning in all these kind of problems and their sub problems. So obviously there will be multiple sub problems, like maybe power control in cellular network or maybe power control in, you know, other kinds of networks or such kind of things. So yeah, enough about the initial motivation. I hope I am able to motivate you enough to actually look into reinforcement learning and why we should talk about reinforcement learning. So now let us start discussing that, what is this reinforcement learning? You know, what is what goes on in this enforcement learning. So this is very high level diagram about reinforcement learning. So in reinforcement learning, what we have is an agent. Okay, this agent is basically your control algorithm. Okay, so to solve any problem, you're going to design a solution. That solution is mostly kind of either a control law or a control algorithm, right? Or sometimes a computer program as well. So in reinforcement learning, we call that thing as an agent, okay? And this agent always takes an action onto an environment. So there are two basic entities. One is an agent, another is an environment, right? This agent has a set of actions, and then those set of actions basically are the decisions that this agent has to make. Like for your investment portfolio, the actions are basically the number of all the different kinds of shares that you have inside your investment portfolio, or the number of shares that are there in the stock market. Your action would be either to buy that share or sell a share, right? So this agent, they always take actions on the environment, and by virtue of taking action on the environment, they change the environment a bit. So whenever an agent takes an action on the environment, it modifies the environment in some manner, right? Like whenever you sell a share or buy a share, you have changed the state of the stock market. Okay, whatever was the state maybe 1 minute ago, once you bought the share, the state has changed. Then this agent also perceives this new state and also gets some reward from the environment. So this is how the cycle goes on. Agent takes action on the environment, and then after taking the action, agent perceives the state, whatever is the current state, and also receives some kind of reward from the environment. And now based on what state is perceived and what rewards are received, it makes another decision of taking another action. And this goes on. Okay. So in this setup, what reinforcement learning tries to learn or tries to optimize is this reward signal. Okay. So I hope you can understand what could be a reward signal. Like for autonomous driving car, the reward would be never to actually cause any accident or, you know, hit another car on the road. Or for your stock market or investment portfolio example, the reward is all the profits that you are making. Sometimes the reward could be negative. So instead of calling them penalties, we simply call the rewards are negative. Okay, so sometimes whenever you take an action, you could also get negative rewards. But the aim of this agent is to maximize this reward signal. Means the agent wants to take only those actions in all the different states such that the total reward it receives at the end of this cycle is always maximized. Okay, so how to achieve that? So we're going to learn about how to achieve this, but I hope this setup is clear to you that there is an agent, there is an environment. Obviously, there is a state space and an action space. The agent always takes an action on the environment, and then from the environment, the agent receives the state and the reward. Now let's get a little more formal. So this kind of reinforcement learning setup so there is a properly defined mathematical framework called Markov decision process. And these reinforcement learning setups are basically described using such Markov decision processes. So as the name suggests, all these Markov decision processes follow the Markovian property. What does the Markovian property say? It simply says that in order to make any decision, okay, about the next action or about the next stage to go to, we use the information only in the current state, or all the information from the very beginning till the current time is stored in the current state. So we don't have to actually take care of the history. That is what it says, that if you're taking a lot of actions, so whenever you take an action, you go to a state, then you take another action, go to another state, and you keep on going, right? So we cannot keep track of this whole history because this history could be very long, okay? So this Markov property says that, or Markov assumption basically says that maybe all this, the information related to this whole history is stored in a single state, that is your current state. And whenever you have to make any decision, you just look into your current state and make that decision. So we're going to follow or, you know, keep that assumption here. And then we, inside the MDP setup, there are different components, which includes, so you have a set of states, your state space, okay? Then you have a set of actions, that is also called the action space. Then you have something called a transition model or a transition function. So this function just tells us that what is the probability of going to a next state given your current state and current action, right? So that means if your current state for a autonomous driving car, for a self-driving car, current state is maybe it is driving at a speed of 20 kilometer per hour on a road, okay? And the observation also says that maybe there is a speed breaker in the front. So the action would be, maybe the action is apply brakes. So if you're moving at 20 kilometer per hour and you apply brake, what should be your next state? So what is the probability of going to one of the next states? So you can have a set of next states. So one of the next state would be your car simply stops. Another of the next state would be maybe your car doesn't stop, it skids, right? So there is a probability that 90% of the time your car will definitely stop, but maybe there is a 10% of the time your car may skid. Okay, so this transition function tells us that probability distribution over a set of different next states. Then you have a reward function, which is also dependent on the state, right? So this reward function is nothing but a numeric signal. It's a number, okay? So whenever you apply an action on a state, in return, the environment gives you a reward, a number, okay? And this number, it's a real number. So this number could be positive and could be negative depending on what actions you have applied and what changes it caused in the environment, right? Then you have a start state or a distribution over the start state. So a start state is where you start your whole process, right? So like for autonomous driving, again, the start state would be some start location and you want to go to some destination location. For your investment portfolio, your start state could be if you're looking for a single day, then whatever is your current account balance, right? But if you're looking for a long run, like a 5-year period, then the start state could be maybe with a empty portfolio or something like that, okay? And there may be or may not be terminal state. So that's why it's a maybe, okay? So you could have a kind of a continuous state action kind of task which doesn't end. Like again, driving of your autonomous vehicle, it doesn't end. Maybe if you don't explicitly define a destination, then it is a continuous task, okay? But then there are tasks like the game of chess. In the game of chess, there is a proper end state, like the game will end. So there may be a terminal state, there may not be a terminal state. And if there are terminal state, there could be multiple terminal states, okay? So this is all the formalism that we have in a reinforcement learning setup. And that is described using an MDP. Now let us see the basic elements of a reinforcement learning in reinforcement learning. So there are four basic elements, that is policy, reward, value function, and model of the environment. Okay, the first one, policy, is the core of reinforcement learning. Okay, it defines actually the core of reinforcement learning. So what is a policy? Policy defines the agent's behavior at any given time. Now, I hope you understood what is an agent. The agent is basically who is making decisions, right? Who is making decision to take different kinds of actions on the environment. So what would be agent's behavior? What is the meaning of agent's behavior? The meaning of agent's behavior is simply what action to take in what state, isn't it? So what action to take in what state is the agent's behavior. And we want to learn such an agent behavior, right? We want to learn such an agent behavior such that we maximize our rewards. Means the agent behavior should be as such that whenever it takes an action, we always get a positive reward and the maximum possible positive reward. Okay. So that's why we want to learn this. And policy actually defines the core of reinforcement learning problem. How do we learn policy? So then that is the difficult part, right? We simply said that, okay, policy is nothing but agent's behavior. It just tells the agent what action to take in which state. And we want to learn the best possible policy. But the representation of policy, it's not bounded, right? It's not very structured. It's a very unstructured representation where in each state you there are multiple actions available and you may take any action, right? So we want to have a very concrete and structured objective which we can achieve, and those objectives are defined using a reward signal. So reward signal tells us that what are the good and bad events for the agent in an immediate sense. What is the meaning of immediate sense? So as soon as the agent takes the action, it receives the reward for that action, right? But then there are concerns, because something which is good immediately may not be good in the long run, and something which is bad immediately may not be bad in the long run. Okay, so I hope you understand that. That may be an action that you take now or a decision that you make now may be giving you something, a better reward. But in the long run, if you could have waited, you could have got even a better reward, right? So rewards are mostly immediate, and that's why it doesn't, so it gives you a kind of greedy nature and doesn't actually help you in the long run in order to, you know, learn a good behavior or learn a good policy. So then there is another element called value function. And what is a value function? A value function indicates the long-term desirability of states. Okay, I think this term is, this sentence is a little cryptic. So in a very simple sense, it says the value function is the total amount of reward that an agent can expect to accumulate over the future. Now understand this, a value function is the total amount of reward an agent can expect to accumulate over the future. So that means if your current state is S, okay? So what value function is telling that if you start from your current state S and there is some terminal state, how much reward you can accumulate from the current state while you reach to your terminal state or the end state. So this is a kind of a prediction problem. Value function tries to predict the future, that how much reward you can accumulate starting in this state. And so this is again a very important element, and we're going to discuss a lot about value function in further slides, that what is this prediction and how this prediction is going to help us to learn a policy. So all these are related. We'll see that how all these elements are related to one another. Another thing is, this value function is not actually given in the problem setup or in the this Markov decision process components. Okay, this is something that we are defining for reinforcement learning. This is the first term that we are actually defining. Okay, see, rewards are given by the environment. We are assuming that rewards are always available. Okay, so that, yeah, that I missed. So we are also assuming that rewards are encoded in the environment. It's like whenever you buy a share or sell a share, you'll get a reward. You are not defining how much you are going to get. That is defined by the stock market, right? So rewards are embedded in the environment or always given by the environment. Policy is your set of action. You want to learn this. What is value function? This is some function that we want to learn, but we are defining this function. So we are giving the definition of a function calling value function, which tells us that starting in the current state, how much reward I can accumulate going into the future. And lastly, the element is the model of the environment. Model of the environment is nothing but it tells us that how the environment behaves. Okay, so we want to learn how we are going to behave in the best possible manner, or our agent is going to behave in the best possible manner. And there is a model of the environment which tells us that how the environment behaves. So what is the behavior of the environment? So basically, whenever you take an action on the environment, okay, what possible next state the environment will go to? Many a time, this model of the environment is also not present, right? So we'll see that when the model of the environment is not present, then how do we apply RL methods and all that? We'll discuss that. But history is also one of the very important elements of reinforcement learning. So after defining these basic elements, let us discuss or try to understand a little bit more about rewards and policies and how they affect the agent's behavior. Okay, so I'm going to assume a kind of this kind of grid environment, right? And there are two terminal states, this plus one and this minus one. And as it is written, plus one is a higher reward, high negative reward. And this is the environment. This is a block, like this is an obstacle. So you cannot cross this block, this particular block, okay? And here, the agent can take four actions. What are the four actions? Up, down, left, and right. So the agent can take four actions. And we want to train an agent. We want to train the agent's behavior to learn the best policy in the environment. What is the best? What is the meaning of best policy here? So if you place the agent anywhere in this environment, okay, it should achieve the reward possible from that location going to the goal state or the terminal state. Okay, so wherever you want to place the agent, you place it. And the policy of the agent or the behavior of the agent should guide the agent to get the maximum possible reward in this environment. So straight away, you can see that the maximum possible reward possible in this environment is this plus one reward. That if you achieve this, you'll get the maximum possible reward. Then there is some noise in the environment. What is the noise? So whenever the agent tries to take its intended action, so let's say the agent wants to take the action of going up, there's an 80% chance that it will definitely go up, but there's a 10% chance that it may go right or left. Okay, so whenever the agent, if you take another direction, maybe the agent is trying to go to left, okay? So if the agent is trying to go to left, there is an 80% chance that it will definitely go to left, but there is a 10% chance that it may go to up or down. Okay, so there is a 20% noise in the system. Now, this is a final learned policy. So these arrows tells that what is the best action in all these states when the living reward here is minus 0.01. What is the meaning of living reward? So whenever the agent take any action in this environment, in this grid, it gets a reward of minus 0.01. Okay, and except these two states. These two states have their own reward and these are also exit state. The only action possible is exit action. And in all other cases, the agent will always receive this negative reward. Now you see when I change this living reward, how the policy of the agent changes. Okay, so I have four examples here. Had reward of minus 0.01. See this state, this particular, maybe you can call it what, 4-3, right? So this 4-3 state, here the agent is trying to hit the wall. And whenever the agent tries to hit the wall, it remains in the same state. Do you think it is the best possible policy? See, some of you might argue that this is may not be the best possible policy, that why the agent is trying to hit the wall. Here also, if you see, the agent is trying to hit the wall. Why the agent is doing that? Because what we said, we want to learn that always gives us the maximum possible reward. In this environment, because there is some noise, if we say that the agent takes straight away the left action, then there is always a 10% chance that the agent may end up in this negative state. And once you end up here, the game finishes and you get a minus one reward. So in the long run, this may be likely. Okay, so in the long run means if you do 100 tries, obviously out of those 100 tries, 10 times you're going to get into this particular state and getting a minus one, which may be costly. While if you just keep on hitting this wall, again, there is a 10% chance that you will reach here because 80% of the time you will not reach. But there is a 10% chance that you will definitely reach to this state and then you can follow the policy from there and get a plus one, right? And when you're hitting the wall, how much negative you're getting? Minus 0.01, right? So even it will take at least, what, 100 tries to get a minus one? 100 tries is already enough. Before that only you will actually reach to this state and may start following the policy. However, when you change this reward that you get from the environment, the living reward, to minus 0.03, see how the behavior of the agent suddenly changed. Now, hitting the wall and leaving the environment is actually more costly because this number quickly becomes minus one. So here the agent has started taking risk. Here there was no risk. It is playing very safe, but here the agent has started taking risk. Okay. And then it learned a policy that whatever happens, maybe I should take the left. And I'll take a 10% chance. Again, you made the environment even more difficult for the agent. So the reward now becomes 0.04 to live in the environment. And you see how the behavior changed. Okay. So you can see this particular state. This particular state was always going this way, you know, towards the left for this plus one. Now it changed the direction. Why? Because now moving in this direction, this is a long path, 2+1, right? A longer path is actually going to cost me more. Instead, I'll take a shorter path. Why earlier I was not taking a shorter path? Because in this particular middle state, there is a 10% chance that I may end up here. So I don't want to take any risk of ending up in this minus one. But here, oh, we had to take that risk because living in the environment is now very difficult. The environment is giving a lot of penalties. And if you actually make the reward in the environment as very difficult, like, you know, minus two means actually living in the environment is worse than going to the terminal state. So see how the behavior of the agent suddenly changes. It prefers going to a terminal state and getting a minus one than actually living in the environment and, you know, getting this penalty of minus two. So the aim of actually showing you this example is the relationship between rewards and the policies. So the policy that your agent is going to learn, what is the meaning of policy? The behavior, right? The what actions to take in different states. That is very much affected by what kind of rewards that are there in the environment. So for the same environment, if rewards are coded differently, the agent behavior that will be learned is going to be different. Okay. So rewards play a very important role. And again, there is a whole research domain dedicated to actually reward shaping or how should reward be distributed in the environment and so on, because this is a very simple grid world environment. But then there are very complex environment and it's very difficult to design rewards for those kind of environments. Okay. But for most of our discussion, we are going to assume that somebody told us the reward and rewards are there, which is always going to help us to learn the best policy. Okay. So we are not going to discuss that where is the reward and how to find the reward. Reward is there in the environment. It is the best possible reward encoded in the environment. We don't know the reward, but we can discover the reward in the environment. This is going to be our assumption throughout this discussion of today. So now let us become a little more formal and try to define a goal or an objective of the reinforcement learning agent. So in mostly reinforcement learning literature, we always talk from the point of view of reinforcement learning agent. It's a single agent which is trying to learn a policy. So for any agent, the goal is always the maximization of the expected value of the cumulative sum of reward received in the long run. See, this last part, received in the long run, is important. That means maybe if in the current episode, in the current cycle, you did not get or you could not get the maximum possible reward, that is okay. Okay. Maybe in the long run, maybe if you keep on, you know, going through the cycle and running a policy, you will get more reward later. Okay, maybe initially less rewards are coming, but then you're getting better and better. And later on, you're getting more and more rewards. That is okay. We are okay with it. Okay. So, but at the end, means when all the runs finishes, okay, we should focus on maximizing this cumulative sum of rewards. Right? So that is the aim. And if you would like to, so what we are saying, what is the, if you want to write it mathematically, the aim is simply, so we can write as the aim as the goal. The goal of the agent is simply that sum of rewards possible in the environment, right? So starting at time t, the agent is looking to maximize the cumulative sum of reward, okay? So that means what is the reward it is going to get at t plus 1, time t plus 2, up till the final time step R capital T. Okay. So the aim of the agent is to maximize this quantity GT. Okay. So whenever now we are going to talk about GT, we mean this sum of rewards. Okay. And in more general sense, okay, in a very generalized manner, we have to call it as the expected return. So most of the time in reinforcement learning literature, the goal is also called returns. Okay. Both means the same. So returns is basically sum of reward till the final time step. And again, since we are going to talk about a lot of cycles, and in different cycle, the agent may choose different action based on the policy. and the policy could be not a, only a deterministic policy, could be a stochastic policy, right? Mm-hmm. All of you. So let's resume our discussion. So we were talking about this objective of reinforcement learning agent, right? So we said that the objective is simply to maximize the expected value of cumulative sum of rewards. A little bit cryptic way of writing the sum of rewards, but again, it is important because every time the agent may not take the same action, because the agent could have a policy that gives some probability of taking action A and some probability of taking action B. So whenever the agent in that state, it can take different actions at different point of time, right? So that's why you have this word here, expected return. Oh, so you need to calculate an expectation, which won't be easy to calculate. So we have to see how should we calculate that. But in very simple terms, the goal is just the future sum of rewards. The important point is future sum of rewards. You're not actually summing up the rewards that you have achieved till now, starting from the start state. The aim is to achieve the reward starting from the current state, going into the future till the last state. Okay, so that is very important. We want to focus on this future sum of reward. So that's the expected value we are looking for, and we want to maximize that average or expected value. Okay, now, so where this T is the final time step. And as we had discussed that many a times we could have a terminal state where everything finishes. And when we have these kind of terminal state in our system, we call those sequences which ends in a terminal state as episodic sequences. Okay, or we call them simply episodes. It's like playing the game of chess. So if you're training an agent to play the game of chess against a human, right? So that agent may not learn in just one game, but we know that the game is going to end because the game will definitely end at some point, right? So that is a kind of episode. So we are going to call that is one episode that the agent has just seen, and maybe the agent has to see many episodes to learn, okay? But many times we have continuing sequences, like your self-driving car. When your self-driving car is going to end receiving rewards, may never, right? For your self-driving car, the learning never ends. It has to continuously learn to optimize and learn newer behaviors as the environment is evolving, because the environment is already very complex. So for this continuing sequences, this final time step T is actually at infinity. Okay, now this creates a bit of trouble for us. Why? See, how we defined our goal. Our goal is this sum of rewards, no, simple sum. But if I say that this particular last time step is at infinite, right? So if this last time step is at infinite, what would be the sum of rewards? The sum of rewards till infinite would be infinite. And if I have an indeterminate kind of this infinite kind of quantity as my goal or as my objective, I can't learn an infinite, right? I can't learn an indeterminate term. So that creates a bit of trouble for us, because we would like to have the definition of this objective little more generic, which can cover both kind of this episodic and continuing kind of task, right? So in order to solve that problem, what people have come up with is called discounting. Oh, so people have come up with a technique called discounting, and that actually solves our this infinity problem. So what they do, so in order to bound our goal, in order to bound our return, okay, what this is, let us give more value, okay, to the rewards received in near future than those that will be received later in future time step. So this simply says that let us create some kind of mechanism, okay, so that the rewards that we are going to get receive in near future, very near, like in next two time step, like three time step, next four time step, we give those rewards more importance than the reward that we will receive after 1000 time step, because time is continuous, right? So we know that time is not going to end anywhere. So we are going to give some kind of weightage to all the rewards that we will be receiving. And we would like to use this kind of weighting of rewards in order to bound our goal or bound our expected return. So how to achieve this? So the simple idea or the simple method to achieve this, which is used to calculate this expected discounted return, is simply multiply a quantity like this small quantity gamma, where gamma is a parameter which is between 0 to 1, okay? And as you're going in the future, keep on increasing the index of this gamma. Okay, so whatever is this exponent, keep on increasing that exponent of gamma as you go into the future, right? So now our this goal or the objective is not simply a sum of rewards, but a discounted sum of rewards, where these are the discounting factor. This gamma, gamma square are the discounting factor that we have multiplied with all the rewards that are there. Okay, so if we want to write this very concisely, we can simply write it as using the summation symbol, right? So we can write it as summation k equals to 0 to infinite gamma raised to power k. So everywhere there is gamma and the power is changing. So there is gamma raised to power k and your reward. So RTK plus 1. Okay, same thing is written in a more concise manner. However, if you look into this term, and if it is given to you that gamma is always a value between 0 to 1, right? Now, if I tell you that maybe all these rewards are bounded with some value called R max. So what is the R max I'm talking about? I'm saying that in any state, the maximum reward that you can receive is R max. You can never receive a reward more than R max. Okay, so let's say all these rewards that we received is R max. Because we know we can never receive a reward more than R max, that's the upper bound. So if you replace all these individual rewards by R max and take R max as common, what is left with you is 1 plus gamma, right? Plus gamma square and gamma cube and gamma raised to power 4 and so on till infinity. If you look into this expression, this is simply a geometric progression. That is GP sum to infinity. And we all know from our, high school mathematics, how to sum a infinite sequence, a GP, right? Of infinite sequence. We know that, right? What is the summation? It is 1 by 1 minus gamma. So with this trick, what we did or what did we achieve is, even for continuing task, now we have a bound on our return value, on our goal. That means now we can always calculate the goal, right? Whether it is an episodic task, whether it is a continuing task, we can always calculate the goal. Another thing is, this gamma also gives us a kind of generalization. So what is that kind of generalization this gamma gives us? So if I put the gamma value as 0, let us say that we put gamma value as 0. If we put gamma value as 0, all the terms from t plus 2 onwards becomes 0. That means we are only looking into our immediate rewards. We are very greedy. So we just start looking into our immediate rewards. And if I put gamma as 1, so if I simply put gamma as 1, all these terms becomes the simple sum of reward. So it becomes RT plus 1 plus RT plus 2 plus RT plus 3 because all the gammas becomes 1, right? So then the whole thing changes to our earlier definition of sum of reward. So all these variants have specific names. Like when you have gamma equals to 1, that is called a total reward criterion, right? All these are different objective function that you can use to optimize. When can you use gamma equals to 1? When you have episodic task, because you know the task is going to finish. So you can always calculate a bounded quantity or bounded return. Okay, so you can use gamma equals to 1. But if you have a continuing task, then you may not use gamma equals to 1. You have to use a gamma value somewhere between 0 to 1. Okay, so I hope that is clear. And the way we defined our goal for reinforcement learning problem. So finally, this is our goal. What we want to achieve in our reinforcement learning setting is we want the agent to maximize this quantity. We are talking a little bit in terms of optimization that we would like to maximize this quantity as much as possible. Okay. And we also saw or we discussed that how this quantity is bounded. Okay, we are always going to get a numeric sum, like a number out of it, not an indeterminate term. Okay, let's move on. So now we can even become more formal, and now we can again revisit our value function. Remember, one of the elements of RL, and be more specific about the value function. So there are two kinds of value function that are defined. One is called a state value function, usually represented by V of pi for a state S. And there is another value function called state action value function. So it not only takes in the state, but also the action that you're going to that you have taken in a state. Okay. So both these value function assigns a value. And what is the definition of value function that we discussed? The value represents how much reward you can achieve starting in the state S and going into the future. Right? That means the value function shows the potential of all the states. And that is the cryptic term that we use, that it shows the long-term desirability of all the states. Right? So I hope that is clear. Long-term desirability means how important are these states? And this is going to help us actually to make our decision that which state we should go to. Obviously, you would like to go to a state which has higher value, isn't it? Because that ultimately translates to actually maximizing a reward. Because the states having higher value says that if you go through that state, you're going to get a lot of rewards in the future. Okay. Formally, again, both these value functions are nothing but the expected return. Okay. So V pi of S, or the state value function, is the expected return when you start in the status, and follow a policy pi. So here we are assuming that somebody told us some policy. The agent already has a behavior. Okay, we're not learning the behavior. We're trying to learn the value now, because this value we're going to use to learn the better behavior later. So currently we're assuming that some policy is given, and using that policy for all the states, we're trying to learn a value function. Okay. So it tells that the value function is the expected return when we start in the state S and follow policy pi, right? And more formally, you can define it as the expectation of the return when you're starting in the state S. And we know the definition of this expectation. What is it? Is the discounted sum of rewards, right? Expected discounted return. So the expected discounted return is, this is the formula for that. We just saw that formula. So you can simply write it like this. Okay. Many a times, it's not only the state, but the action that you took in the state also matters a lot, right? So a similar kind of terminology is also defined for the state action pair, and you can associate a value for each state action pair. So what is the value of a state action pair, which we usually denote as Q, and this is this value, Q value, which actually gave the Q learning algorithm. So we're going to discuss the Q learning algorithm, which is one of the most famous reinforcement learning algorithms. Mostly people use Q learning algorithms. So the Q value is basically the value means the reward, okay, that you can accumulate going into the future when you start in state S and take action A. Okay, so nothing changes, everything, all the definition remains the same. Here, the extra thing you're adding is you're also considering the action that you're taking in that state, okay, in order to calculate this Q value. Again, pi is given, so we are considering that the policy is given to us. Now let us try to define some optimality notion. Okay, so we said that we want to learn the best possible behavior. Okay, what is the definition of that best possible behavior? Like if at any point of time somebody actually gave you the best possible behavior, how do you know that you have the best possible behavior? Okay, so we should have a notion of what is the optimal policy. What is the best policy? So a policy pi is defined to be better or equal to another policy pi dash. So we're just comparing two policies, pi and pi dash. Okay. If the expected return is greater than and equal to that of pi dash for all the states. So what we are saying, that a policy pi, right? A policy pi is better than the policy pi dash if and only if the value of all the states under pi, v of pi, right? We just defined it. So the value of all the states under policy pi is greater than or equal to the value pi dash. Okay. So if the, if you're, somebody gave you two behaviors, two policies, and asked you the question that, tell me which one is the best behavior, right? Tell me which strategy is the best strategy. Like your, let's say you have these share market consultants, right? Who tell you that, okay, buy this share, sell this share and all that. So if you hire two such consultants, or if you talk to two such consultants, both of them give you a kind of policy, right? Both of them will tell you, okay, buy this share and sell these shares, but they may be different shares. How do you evaluate that? Which one told you, like whose suggestions or the consultancy is better? So that you can only evaluate that who is giving you better return, isn't it? You'll say that, okay, yeah, the person one, whatever he told me actually gave me better return than person two. Same logic is applied here. So if you have two policy, pi and pi dash, the best way to evaluate or compare those policies is look into their value function. What is the value function? It tells you what is the reward that you can accumulate for each state, right? So whichever policy has a better value function, that policy is better. Now you can extend this logic for all possible policies that are there, right? For each environment, like for the game of chess, there could be some k number of strategies to play the game, right? And you'd like to compare those strategies, and you want to use the best possible strategy to play the game, right? So if you use this logic, and if you compute the value of all possible policies and keep on comparing, ultimately you will have a policy which is, you will have a policy pi which is greater than all other policies, which is either greater than or equal to all other policies. That policy is obviously the best policy in that environment. And we are going to call that policy as the optimal policy pi star. Oh, so this is just a definition. And this definition is from this optimality notion that we just created, that a policy is, so among two policies, policy, one policy is better than the other policy if its value function is better than the other's value function. So I hope now you understand that we got a tool to compare different policies. And that tool is basically designed using the value function. So the focus now have to shift to calculation of this value function, because now we know if we can calculate the value function, we can always get a better policy, or actually compare the policy and select the better policy. And selecting the better policy means taking the best action, which gives us the maximum reward. So I hope you understand everything, how everything is connected here. Another thing is, there may be more than one optimal policy. Okay, so there may be more than one better strategy to, again, going to the stock market example, there may be more than one strategy to actually invest, buy shares, sell, and sell the shares in the stock market. And all of them could give you the same maximum return. Okay, so for the same maximum return that is there, there could be multiple paths to that return. And that multiple paths are multiple optimal policy. So it is definite that there exists at least one. You'll always have at least one optimal policy. Means there is always one policy which is at the top based on this logic. But there could be more than one. So the equality is also there. Okay. So there could be more than one optimal policy also. And all these optimal policies, okay, they share the same state value and action value. That means, for all the optimal policy, their V pi is also the same. So obviously, based on V pi only, you're saying that they are optimal, right? If their V pi's are equal, then you will say that the policies are also equal. Okay. And all those policies will be optimal policies. Okay. So extending, now our aim, I hope the focus is clear. We want to learn the optimal policy, but the road to this optimal policy goes via the value function. So we have to focus on value function in order to learn the optimal policy. Right. So yeah, bit of more math here, but that is necessary. if you want to learn reinforcement learning. So there is again a model-based formalization of these value functions that we just discussed, okay? And there's a very famous Bellman equation that are used again in MDPs, in multi-unbanded problems, and obviously in reinforcement learning literature a lot. What this Bellman equation tells us, it gives us a recursive relationship among the value functions, okay? So what is this recursive relationship? So basically it tells us that we can actually calculate the value function of a state S, okay, using the value function of another state S dash, where S dash also belongs, S and S dash both belongs to our state space. Okay, so this is a kind of recursive relationship, because if we can calculate the value of this S using this S dash, then we can also calculate the value of this S dash using some S double dash, and then from S double dash to S triple dash and so on. Okay, so it defines this kind of a recursive relationship among the states, right? And what are these quantities? So this is basically your policy. This is the kind of stochastic policy, means this, when we write the policy like this, pi of A given S, it simply tells us what is the probability of taking action A in state S, and we sum over all the actions. So probability is always going to sum to one, we know that. What is this? This is the model of the environment. That's why it is called model based. Okay. So this is the model of the environment, which tells us what is the probability of going to next state and receiving the reward R when you are actually in state S and taking action. So both these terms, pi and p, are probabilities, and they're multiplied by this quantity, which is your reward, the next reward that you're going to receive, plus gamma times the value of your next state S dash, the next state that you're, where you're going to go from this state. Okay. So this Bellman equation gives us a nice structure to our value function in terms of a equation. Okay. And if you see, this is basically a linear equation. So if you write the value function of all possible states, you will get a set of, let's say if the size of S is n, then you'll get a set of n linear equations with n unknowns. What are the unknowns here? The value function, the value of a state is an unknown. So you have a set of system of linear equation with n unknowns, and there are n equations. You can obviously solve it, right? We all of us know that how to solve a system of linear equations. Okay, what is the problem? The problem is, obviously, this set of states are going to be in hundreds or thousands, and whatever method you employ to solve these set of linear equation, it will have a complexity of order n cube. Means it is going to take a lot of time to solve these equations because of so many unknowns. So that's why it's a little tricky, or it's little not so trivial to solve these set of linear equations. Again, Bellman equation also established a kind of relationship between this value function of state and the value function of state and action. It simply says the value function of a state is basically an expectation over the Q function of the state and action. So for all state, for a single state and all the actions in that state, if you take a weighted sum and the weights here are the policy values, then that is the value function. So these are very two important relationships that is given by Bellman equation. Obviously there are derivations for it, but we are not going there. Then there is also a Bellman optimality equation, which simply says that the value of a state under an optimal policy. So if you have found the optimal policy, okay, then something's changed. At optimality, when you have the optimal policy, and then if you're trying to calculate the value, so instead of a summation over all action, it is basically a max over all the action that you can use with this recursive relationship to calculate the value. Now the trouble here is, obviously we want to calculate this optimal value, because we know once we have the optimal values, maybe we, with some method, we can extract the optimal policy out of it. Okay. The problem is, this now becomes a non-linear equation. See, here these are linear equations, but this becomes a non-linear equation, and the non-linearity is because of this max function. We know the max function is not a linear function. And then now you have a set of non-linear equations. Non-linear equations, as you know, are very difficult to solve, right? So then it creates a trouble for us, and we have to now see into algorithms which can help us to solve these kind of complicated equations in order to get the value function. And then we have to see a method that how, after getting the value function, we can get a better policy. So now this is the slide that lists all possible RL method to do so. So to do what? To do what we just discussed, solving those Bellman equation. So basically solving those Bellman equation actually solves your problem. If you are able to solve the equations, the problem is those equations are very hard to solve. Okay. So as I have listed here, there are basically two broad approaches. One is called the, let me change the color of it. Yeah. So one of the method is called model-based methods. Another method is called model-free method. So the so what is model-based and model-free method? So in model-based method, we assume that we have this quantity. What is this quantity? It is the transition function. It tells that if you're in a state S and you take action A, what is the next state that you will go to and what is the reward that you will get? So if you are going to make this assumption that you have access to this model of the environment, then it is a model-based method. So Bellman equations are defined using the model-based method, using the model of the environment. But most of the time, and most of in your real world problems, you don't have the model of the environment because it's very difficult to get such model of the environment. Okay. But we still like to use reinforcement learning to solve our problems. So then there are model-free methods that directly try to learn these value function without making any assumption on the model of the environment. We know there is model of the environment which is hidden in the environment. It is very difficult for us to actually capture that model. So we let go of it and we directly try to learn this value function without the model of the environment. So those are called model-free methods. Okay. So we have model-based methods and we have model-free methods. Now within model-based methods, there are dynamic programming-based methods, which are again divided into policy iteration and value iteration. We'll try to touch upon these two methods in next few slides. And there's also approximate dynamic programming methods. So what happens in approximate dynamic programming? So it here, these methods first try to approximate the model of the environment. Okay, so by taking multiple samples from the environment or recording a lot of data, they try to approximate what is the model of present in the environment. And once you have the model of the environment, which is again approximated, you can use these policy iteration and value iteration method to solve the reinforcement learning problem. Okay, then you have model-free methods, and mostly like the most prominent ones in model-free methods are Monte Carlo methods and temporal difference method. The temporal difference method is also called TD methods. And then there are two very famous TD methods. One is called SARSA, and another is called Q-learning. So today we'll try to touch upon Q-learning if time permits, right? And then there are other, you can say state of art methods, because these are very basic methods now, as per the current standard, current state of art. Because now people are using deep learning to solve reinforcement learning problem. Those are called deep reinforcement learning methods. And then there are various varieties of these deep reinforcement learning methods. Okay, so broadly there are three ways or three method, three advanced methods. One is the value-based methods, which tries to learn the value function. Okay, maybe using deep learning and you know different models of deep learning, so like there is a deep Q network model, which is based on Q learning and deep learning. So they mix these two and they have created deep Q networks. Okay, DQ and they call it. So there are many value-based methods. This is one of them. Then there is policy-based method. So there are methods which try to directly learn the policy. Even, you know, they skip value and they directly try to learn the policy. But again, there are specific kind of environments and kind of problems where you can directly learn the policy. It's not always possible. Okay, there are some limitations. So there are policy-based methods which directly try to learn the policy. And then there are active-critic methods. These methods try to use both policy and value. Okay, so they have big neural networks and they they make use of values in order to learn the policy. Like they mix both of these into something called actor critique methods. So this is broadly all the different reinforcement learning methods, you know, that are there. Again, you can have a lot of subcategories in each one of them. A lot of varieties are available. Like in SARSA also, there are N-step SARSA, there's SARSA Lambda, and so on. Similarly for Q-learning, there are multiple varieties that are available. But if you can cover this much, like all these model-based methods and all these model-free methods, you can say that you have covered all the basics of reinforcement learning. Okay. And after that, obviously, all these methods are some way, one way or the other, derived from these kind of methods. Okay. So let us start with some, let us try to understand a few of those methods, if time permits. So as I can see, I got 15 minutes or so. So let's see, whatever, how much we can cover, we'll try to cover. So in model-based methods, let us first try to discuss policy evaluation. So policy evaluation is something similar that we discussed when we talked about optimal policies, right? What we said, given a policy, if I can find the value function, I can make use of the value function to compare that policy with other policies. That is what we said. Okay, so let us now try to evaluate the policy, means try to calculate the value function for a particular policy. We saw the Bellman equation. We know that we can calculate the policy by solving the set of those Bellman equations, but it is very difficult. So we are going to have an iterative approach, means a very simple approach to solve those or to get the value of a particular policy. Okay, so how that is done? Basically, we try to calculate the value of each state iteratively in each iteration. Okay, and the value of a state in next iteration is given by the Bellman equation. We simply capture the Bellman equation. Again, these are model-based methods. So we're assuming that this model of the environment is given to us, right? This particular probability value is given to us. Policy, somebody told us, we are actually evaluating this policy pi. We want to know the value of this policy pi. So we know the policy. So these two quantities are known to us. Those are ticked. This we know. Okay. Reward, whenever you take an action in an environment, you will definitely get a reward. So you just have to wait of taking the action. As soon as you take the action, you will get the reward from the environment. Okay. So this is known. Gamma is a parameter that we set, right? This is a hyperparameter. And we have to set this parameter value between 0 to 1. This is discounting, right? We discard discounting. So again, this is a parameter that we will set. We may set it as 0.9. So then this is also known. And then we will make use of some approximate value of the value function in the previous iteration. Okay, so what this simply says is, maybe when we're starting our policy evaluation method, okay, so we may assume that maybe initially, arbitrarily, all the value functions are initialized. Okay, and we are going to use those values here. So if you are going to calculate for the first iteration, these value functions comes from the 0th iteration, means the first initialization. When you're going to calculate for the second iteration, then you're going to use all the value function that you calculated in the first iteration, right? So basically we are using the value of the previous iteration to update the value in the current iteration. And we keep on doing this. We keep on updating the value function, keep on updating. Till what point? Till the value function is not changing a lot. Okay, so till all the value functions becomes very close to each other. Right? So the delta error in between the value function of successive iterations becomes very small, some small theta. And there we stop and we simply say, now whatever we found is actually the value function for this particular policy pi. Okay, so this is called policy evaluation. This is a pseudocode for that. Again, if you look into the pseudocode, it's very simple. Simply says that you run in loop for each state. Okay, and then this is the current value. So you capture the current value in this small variable v. Then you use this equation here, okay? And you try to calculate the new value. Then now you have calculated the new value. Once you have calculated the new value, you calculate the difference between the current value and the last value. And if the difference is less than theta, you stop. So means theta bit of error is okay with us, right? And if you keep on doing it in successive iteration, if you do it long enough, where k is very high, means k tending to infinity, means a lot of iterations, then there is a theorem which says that this particular value function will converge to v of pi, means the actual value function of that particular policy. Okay, it's a very simple algorithm. So what we gain from this algorithm, now given a policy, we know what is the value of that policy using this algorithm. Okay, now let us try to improve the policy. We just evaluated the policy. Let us try to improve the policy. Now, in order to improve the policy, there is an algorithm again, which says that if you calculate a greedy policy, okay, if you calculate a greedy policy using your state action values, okay, then whatever is that greedy policy will be a better policy than your current policy. There is a theorem for that. We're not going to discuss the theorem, but there is a theorem which establishes this. Okay, so let us try to calculate a greedy policy. It's very simple. It simply says that your new policy means the action that you want to take in state S, the new action that you want to take in state S, is basically that action which has the maximum QSA value in state S, right? This is argmax. What is argmax? So basically, we want to choose the action which has the maximum QSA in a particular state S. And using the Bellman equation, we know that this QSA can be written in terms of V of S also, the value of the state also. Okay, so we actually can use the value Bellman equation to again convert this QSA in value function. And in the last policy evaluation, we simply calculated this value function for a particular policy pi. So once we know all the values of all the states, we can calculate a better policy pi dash. Right? Now you have calculated a better policy pi dash. What is the next step? Let us again evaluate this better policy and find all the value function for this new policy. Okay? And then we can keep on doing policy evaluation, policy improvement in iteratively till we get the best possible policy. And we have solved the reinforcement learning problem. So this whole algorithm of alternatively using policy evaluation and policy improvement is called policy iteration. So this is called policy iteration. Okay, and what are we doing in policy iteration? So we are basically doing an evaluation step. So we take a policy, we evaluate it, we get V of pi, then we do the improvement step. We improve the policy, we get a new policy, again evaluate, again improve, again evaluate, improve, till you hit the optimality, the optimal policy, the very best policy. Okay, so we go in loops like this and we keep on improving. So I hope this is clear. Okay, so the problem with this algorithm that we just discussed, the policy iteration algorithm, is it is very time consuming. You know why? Because see what we said in policy evaluation, first step. Policy evaluation learns the best or the actual value of all the states, V of pi. When we run that iteratively, that, you know, the value update iteratively for a long, long time. How much will be that long time? We don't know. But it is definitely going to be very long. Okay, it's a lot of iterations we have to do. And then policy improvement is very quick, one step. One step, you just find the max of QSA in all the state and you got a new policy. But again, once you got the new policy, again, you have to go and do the evaluation of that new policy, which is again going to take a lot of time. Okay, so overall, by the time you learn your optimal policy, you have spent a lot of time actually learning. Okay, the method is very simple, but it takes a lot of time. So people do a lot of optimization over that, this kind of a very, time-taking kind of approach. Okay, so value iteration is one such optimization where what they try to do is they try to truncate the policy evaluation step without losing the convergence guarantees. Okay, so I told you there are some theorems which says that you will definitely converge. It's not like you will keep on running for infinity and your values will not converge. They will converge. There is a theorem for that. That's going to take a lot of time. Okay, so people have devised newer techniques, and in one such techniques, they try to truncate the policy evaluation step, okay, and still maintaining that the convergence happen. And that one particular technique is called value iteration. Okay, so let us see what is value iteration. Again, very simple. So what happens in value iteration is you again have your value functions, and you're going to iteratively update this value function, right? But here, you don't have a policy as an input. Means you're not going to assume that somebody gave you a policy and you're evaluating that policy. Okay, you will start with some arbitrary policy, some random policy. And this particular algorithm, okay, it internally keeps on updating the policy with each iteration. Right. So if you see this equation actually looks familiar to you because it is same as your optimality equation. Okay, where we had the max function, right? We said it is all nonlinear. So it makes use of this Bellman optimality equation. And then, so the problem here is at every iteration for each state, you have to find this max function. Now it's very easy to write. But to find the max function, actually, you need to calculate this quantity for all the actions. And then only you can calculate a max. Right? So it's not that easy to calculate, although easy to write. But again, it does perform less number of steps than the policy evaluation step. Okay? And internally, and there is no policy improvement step because of the max function coming here itself. Okay? So because you are always updating the next value based on the max value of the action of the next state, right? So in value iteration, what happens that you keep on running. Now you use this max over A to make all the updates, and you will stop when your, again, values are not changing a lot, means the values are less than some theta, then you will stop. And whatever value you will found by this time is the optimal value function, right? It's not the value function of any particular policy. It's the optimal value function. What is optimal value function? The best value that you can get in that state. It's the best possible reward, maximum reward that you can accumulate from a state. It is that value function. And we already discussed it, right? If you can get the best value function, you extract the policy of that best value function, and that will be the best policy. So that is this last step that is shown here. Okay, so once you got the best value function, you just do this again policy improvement kind of step. Okay, very similar to policy improvement step from your best value, and you'll get a policy, and this is going to be the optimal policy. So this is the value iteration step. Okay, so these are the two dynamic programming based method. Now, why dynamic programming? Because we are actually maintaining all these values in a kind of tabular form, right? And we are again and again making use of it because there's a lot of equations we are solving here. So that's why it is called dynamic programming based methods. Many times they are also called tabular methods. Okay. And again, these tabular methods are very restrictive because you will still have a limit on the size of the tables that you are maintaining for these value functions, right? So they don't scale well. These value iteration, policy iteration, they don't scale well, but they have a lot of nice theory and these convergence guarantees that becomes very difficult to prove if you don't have the model of the environment and, you know, many such things. So it is good for the study and understanding of all the reinforcement learning, like how the convergence happen in reinforcement learning and those kind of, or for the value function or optimal value function. But in reality, we'd like to use algorithms without the model of the environment, right? And then which can scale up to many, many states. So we don't have much time left. Let me quickly browse through and let me find the slide that we can discuss now, okay? So I had an example here where we were trying to calculate the value function for a similar kind of state space that we discussed in the initial slides, but we'll skip that in the interest of time, okay? And I also had model-free methods. Let me just discuss this, one of the model-free method. So in model-free method, what we said that we don't have the model of the environment. The thing is, if you don't have the model of the environment, you cannot write Bellman equation. You cannot use Bellman equation because the one important component of those equations are the model of the environment, right? So if you cannot make use of those equations, then you have to come up with newer methods. So one of those methods is the Monte Carlo estimation method, right? And the technique that we are going to use is the same. Okay, that means policy iteration kind of technique. Here, instead of actually evaluating a policy, we are going to call it as a prediction step. Means we are going to estimate the value of all the states, and we know that once you have the value of all the states, whichever way you calculated, estimated, predicted, whatever, once you have the value, you can always extract a policy out of it. You can always calculate a policy out of it, using that argmax function. So the whole focus is finding the value of all the states, okay? So here is a simple example of Monte Carlo estimation, what we do in Monte Carlo estimation, okay? So here you have this kind of a state space with five states. All these blocks you cannot move because these are obstacles. And you're also given a policy. This is the policy. If you are at B, you'll move towards the right to go to C. If you are at C, you'll move towards the right to go to D. If you are at E, you move towards C, and then from C to D. A and D both are exit states. So once you reach A or D, you exit the system with some reward. We don't know what reward, right? Because the system is not known to us and the model of the environment is not given. If the model of the environment is not available, we don't know where are the rewards, how much is the reward, and what is the probability. So what we do in Monte Carlo methods is, we interact with the system, okay? That means we run the episodes and we capture all the interactions. Means we capture all the actions and the rewards that we are receiving. Okay? So there is an input policy and we're trying to evaluate this input policy. Means we are trying to find what is the value of different state under this policy. Okay, so here are different episodes that was collected. So in episode one, we started with B, we went towards east, we went to C, and we got a reward of -1. So we understood that, okay, within this environment, the living reward is -1. Okay, whenever you make any transition, the reward is always -1. Then from C, we went to D straight away because the policy is telling us to do that. We got a -1. At D, we did the exit option and we get a +10 reward. So D is a very good state. It gives +10 reward. We have discovered this much using episode one. We are again running another episode. This is episode two, again from B, and again same B, C, D, 1, 1, +10. Here, now we are running an episode from E, and we are going to C, and from C again we are going to D, and we are receiving this -1, -1, +10. Again, we are running an episode from E, but here when we are in C and we try to go to east, see the action, C east, it seems there is some noise in the system. Okay, and the probability of that noise is maybe very low here, although it looks like it is 1/4 almost, right? Like 25%. So we are at C and we are taking action east, but instead of going to D, we land up in A because of the noise in the action. And once we land up in A, we get a reward of -1 and we have to do an exit action at A and we get a reward of -10. Means it's a very bad state, right? Now, given these episodes, once you record these interactions from the environment, we can use these interactions to calculate the value function. What is the value function? Starting in this state, how much reward you can accumulate? Simply calculate it. So if you start at B, what is the total reward you accumulated in one episode? +8 here. Again, starting in B, what is the total reward you accumulated? Plus 8 here. And then you never started in B. So what is the value? Simply average those terms and we can say the value is plus 8. Right? This is the average, the expected, right? Here we are calculating the average, not the expectation. It is the average total sum of rewards that you get starting in a particular state. So similarly for all other states, you can, like for C, you can say that, okay, whenever I am in C, what is the total reward I'm getting? So at C, I'll get plus 9 here. At C, I'm getting plus 9 here. C, again, plus 9. Here, I'm getting minus 11. So I'll take an average of 27 minus 11 by 4. So that is like plus 4 you will get. And that is the value of this state. Similarly, we can calculate the value of all the states. Once we have the value of all the states, then you can calculate the policy. We know that. Obviously, there is a problem. Yeah, it's not so simple. The problem is this Monte Carlo estimation works when you have infinitely many episodes to work with, right? Because these four episodes may not be enough. And actually, this is not enough. There is a lot of problem here, the way the values are calculated. So these are not the true values. These are not the actual values of these states. This is some rough estimate, maybe very crude estimate, right? So your estimates will become better and better if you involve a lot of episodes. Okay, so this is a simple Monte Carlo method, which is model free. Okay, where you can evaluate a policy by going through each episode, finding what is the return in each episode and taking an average of that. So I think, yeah, we just crossed the time. So I'll skip. So I wanted to discuss temporal difference, but again, we don't have enough time today for that. So this is Q-learning. This is Q-learning. And if you see the equation of Q-learning, it again uses a very similar equation derived from your Bellman equations, right? And then it makes use of that to do the updates, but again, without any model of the environment. So, okay, anyways, yeah, let me just browse through the slide and if I find anything. So, yes, now let me quickly tell you about this, the deep reinforcement learning. So what people are trying to do in deep reinforcement learning, I hope you have gone through a lot of deep learning literature already in this course that is going on. The architecture remains the same. You still have an agent. Agent takes action on the environment. And the environment, from the environment, the agent observes the next state and gets the reward. However, the model of the agent now is devised using a deep learning model. Okay, so we use deep learning here, where the agent takes state definition as the input and try to predict the action values v of pi. Okay, and we know that deep learning models are very good at doing that. Right, so we use a deep learning model where the input is the state and the current reward. The output is the value function for all possible actions. And then we use that to take the next action. And then you know the rest of the story. Then you can always find a good action and a good policy. Right? Okay, so basically the initial success of this deep learning model was from this NIPS paper. Okay, where they trained a very generic agent to play multiple Atari games. So this was the result for that. I'll skip all these. Okay, you can, if you're interested, you can go and actually read about these things. We have covered all the basics, so I hope it should be okay to you to understand this kind of literature. Right, so okay, I'll skip all these. These are the some of the references, so this is very important. If any of you are interested to read about reinforcement learning more, go to this book, Sutton and Bartow. It is freely available on the internet. They have a web copy also available. Okay. And this is like the starter book or the very basic book of reinforcement learning. Okay. And after reading, going through this book, you can actually go and read any literature on reinforcement learning. Oops, sorry.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so yes. much for the knowledge which you have shared with us. It is line time limitation, otherwise you have so much data to elaborate. As I can see in your slides.
So, right. So this is my last slide. Yes. Thank you. Thank you for inviting me. So this is my email. If any of you want to interact and discuss further, you can always email me. Okay. Thank you. Okay.
Thank you so much, sir. Sir, there is a query in the chat box. By Ms. Pallavi ma'am. Can we use F219?
Okay. Can we use naive Bayes instead of Markov decisions? No, because see, naive Bayes is again a classifier. Okay. It basically performs supervised learning. Okay. It's a generative supervised learning model. But here we are talking of sequential decision making process. So this sequential decision making, you won't be able to use naive Bayes directly. Means you can devise some method, but yeah, not actually to solve the RL problem.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. Sir, can you please stop your screen sharing?
Oh, sorry.
Yeah. All the participants, kindly turn on your cameras for the group photograph, as we have to capture it with us for a record. Kindly turn on your cameras. Okay, thank you so much. Yeah, it's done. Thank you so much all. The attendance link is shared in the chat box. Kindly fill your attendance for this session. Thank you so much, sir.
Okay, thank you. Thanks for having me.